Hey there, I'm Mike, and today I'm going to introduce you to web components. A web component is an easy way to create an encapsulated single responsibility code block that can be reused on any page. In this video, we'll go deeper into using web components on your website and even cover some issues you might face using web components. But before we get too far, I want to let you know that there'll be links to more resources in the video's description. And remember, subscribe and ring that bell to get notifications for future helpful content. So let's get started. Web components are custom HTML elements such as Hello World. The name must contain a dash to never clash with elements officially supported in the HTML specification. You must define an ES2015 class to control the element. It can be named anything, but Hello World is common practice. It must extend the HTML element interface, which represents the default properties and methods of every HTML element. Take note, Firefox allows you to extend specific HTML elements such as HTML paragraph element, HTML image element, or HTML button element. This is not supported in other browsers and does not allow you to create a shadow DOM. To do anything useful, the class requires a method named connected callback, which is invoked when the element is added to a document. In this example, the element's text is set to Hello World. The class must be registered with the custom element registry to define it as a handler for specific element. The browser now associates the Hello World element with your Hello World class when your JavaScript is loaded. You now have a custom element. This component can be styled in CSS like any other element. This component isn't beneficial since the same text is output regardless. Like any other element, we can add HTML attributes. This could override the text so Hello Craig is displayed. To achieve this, you can add a constructor function to the Hello World class, which is run when each object is created. It must first call the super method to initialize the parent HTML element, and then make other initializations. In this case, we'll define a name property that is set on a default of world. Your component only cares about the name attribute. A static observed attributes property should return an array of properties to observe. An attribute change callback method is called when an attribute is defined in the HTML or changed using JavaScript. It's passed the property name, old value, and new value. In this example, only the name property would ever be updated, but you could add additional properties as necessary. Finally, you need to tweak the message in the connected callback method. The browser automatically calls six methods throughout the lifecycle of the web component state. It's called when the component is first initialized. It must call super and can add any defaults or perform other pre-rendering processes. This returns an array of attributes that the browser will observe. This is called whenever an observed attribute is changed. Those defined in HTML are passed immediately, but JavaScript can modify them. The method may need to trigger a re-render when this occurs. This function is called when the web component is appended to a document object model. It should run any required rendering. This is called when the web component is removed from a DOM. This may be useful if you need to clean up, such as removing stored state or aborting AJAX requests. This function is called when a web component is moved from one document to another. Web components offer some unique functionality you won't find in JavaScript frameworks. While the web component we built previously works, it's not immune to outside interference, and CSS or JavaScript could modify it. Similarly, these styles you define for your component could leak out and affect others. The shadow DOM solves this encapsulation problem by attaching a separated DOM to the web component with this code. The mode can either be open, JavaScript in the outer page can access the shadow DOM, or closed. The shadow DOM can only be accessed within the web component. The shadow DOM can be manipulated like any other DOM element. The component now renders the hello text inside a paragraph element and styles it. It cannot be modified by JavaScript or CSS outside of the component, although some styles such as the font and color are inherited from the page because they were not explicitly defined. The style scope to this web component cannot affect other paragraphs on the page or even other Hello World components. Take note that the CSS host selector can style the outer Hello World element from within the web component. You can also set styles to be applied when the element uses a specific class like Hello World with the class Rotate90. Defining HTML inside a script can become impractical for more complex web components. A template allows you to define a chunk of HTML in your page that your web component can use. This has several benefits. First, you can tweak HTML code without having to rewrite strings inside your JavaScript. Second, components can be customized without having to create separate JavaScript classes for each type. And third, it's easier to define HTML in HTML, and it can be modified on the server or client before the component renders. Templates are defined in a template tag, and it's practical to assign an ID so you can reference it within the component class. This example has three paragraphs to display the hello message. The Web Component class can access this template, get its content, and clone the elements to ensure you're creating a unique DOM fragment everywhere it's used. The DOM can be modified and added directly to the Shadow DOM. Slots allow you to customize a template. Presume you wanted to use your Hello World web component, but place the message within a heading in the Shadow DOM. You could write this code. Take note of the slot attribute. You might want to add other elements, such as another paragraph. Slots can now be implemented within your template. An element slot attribute set to message text, the header, is inserted at the point where there's a slot element named message text. The paragraph element does not have a slot name assigned, but it is used in the next available unnamed slot element. In effect, the template becomes this. It's not quite this simple in reality. A slot element in the Shadow DOM points to the inserted elements. You can only access them by locating a slot element, then using the assigned nodes method to return an array of inner children. Here's the updated connected callback method. In addition, you cannot directly style the inserted elements, although you can target specific slots within your web component. Template slots are a little unusual, but one benefit is that your content will be shown if JavaScript fails to run. This code shows a default heading and paragraph that are only replaced when the Web Component class successfully executes. Therefore, you could implement some form of progressive enhancement, even if it's just a "you need JavaScript" message. Previous examples construct a Shadow DOM using JavaScript. That remains the only option, but an experimental declarative Shadow DOM is being developed for Chrome. This allows server-side rendering and avoids any layout shifts or flashes of unstyled content. The following code is detached by the HTML parser, which creates an identical Shadow DOM to the one you created in the last section. You need to update this message as necessary. The feature is not available in any browser, and there's no guarantee it'll reach Firefox or Safari. You can find out more about the declarative Shadow DOM, and a polyfill is simple, but be aware that the implementation could change. Your web component can attach events to any element in the Shadow DOM just like you would in the page DOM, such as to listen for click events on all inner children. Unless you stop propagation, the event will bubble up into the page DOM, but the event will be retargeted. Hence, it appears to come from your custom element rather than the elements within it. Any web component you create will work in all JavaScript frameworks. None of them know or care about HTML elements. Your Hello World component will be treated identically to a div and placed into the DOM where the class will activate. CustomElementsEverywhere.com provides a list of frameworks and web component notes. Most are fully compatible, although React.js has some challenges. It's possible to use Hello World in JSX, but keep in mind, React can only pass primitive data types and HTML attributes, not arrays or objects. React cannot listen for web component events, so you must manually attach your own handlers. Web components have improved significantly, but some aspects can be tricky to manage. Styling web components poses some challenges, especially if you want to override scope styles. There are many solutions, however, including 1. Avoid using the Shadow DOM. You could append content directly to your custom element, although any other JavaScript could accidentally or maliciously change it. 2, use the host classes. As we have seen, scope CSS can apply specific styles when a class is applied to the custom element. 3, check out CSS custom properties or variables. Custom properties cascade into web components, so if your element uses variable myColor, you can set myColor in an outer container and it will be used. 4, take advantage of shadow parts. The new part selector can style an inner component that has a part attribute. 5, pass in a string of styles. You can pass them as an attribute to apply within a style block. None of these solutions are ideal, but you'll need to plan how others can customize your web component carefully. Any input, text area, or select fields in your Shadow DOM are not automatically associated within the containing form. Early web component adopters would add hidden fields to the page DOM or use the form data interface to update values. Neither are particularly practical and break web component encapsulation. The new element internals interface allows a web component to hook into forms so custom values and validity can be defined. It's implemented in Chrome, but a polyfill is available for other browsers. To demonstrate, you'll need to create a basic input age component. The class must have a static form associated value set true, and optionally, a form associated callback method can be called when the outer form is associated. The constructor must now run the attachment internals method, which allows the component to communicate with the form and other JavaScript code, which wants to inspect the value or validation. The element internals set form value method sets the element's value for the parent form initialized with an empty string. Other properties and methods include form, the parent form, labels, an array of elements that label the component. Constraint validation API options such as will validate, check validity, and validation message. The connected callback method creates a shadow DOM as before, but must also monitor the field for changes, so set form value can be run. You can now create an HTML form using the web component, which acts in a similar way to other form fields. It works, but it admittedly feels a little convoluted. With web components, there are kinks to iron out, but the future is bright. They're framework agnostic, lightweight, fast, and can implement functionality that would be impossible in JavaScript alone. Do you have any questions about how to use web components? Let's talk about it in the comments section below. Kinsta's WordPress hosting can speed up your website by up to 200%, and you'll get 24/7 support from our expert WordPress engineers. Let us show you the Kinsta difference. Try a free demo of our My Kinsta dashboard at demo.kinsta.com. And thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe for more tutorials, explainers, and helpful content like this.